Hello and welcome to what is the first stream part of the 2013 New Dimension Racing Kyoto 250. This is the first of two twin 115s that we are going to be showing you this evening. I am Oscar Hardwick. Joining me today is Nolan Scott for the first time in a very long time. Welcome to the commentary box, Nolan.
Well, thank you. It has been a while.
And now, I guess, seeing as we're getting going straight away, it's good to get down to business. The format here is that the top 15 from each twin 115, I believe it's actually the top 14 rather, there's my numbers already going away, from each twin 115 get to qualify into the race. Unless Phil tells me otherwise. In fact, I think he will, because it's the top 11 due to other cars from qualifying being able to come in through basically a last chance qualifying rule. So, with all of that out of the way, horribly, because I was just quoting rules off the back of my head. I've only looked at them about 2 years ago. Go through the grid for you. Robin Friskop's on pole doesn't actually factor into the people qualifying in today because he's the pole sitter for the Kyoto 250. Took pole position in qualifying just a few moments ago. Behind him is Jarl Tyon in the 911 car. Third place is the 73 of Kenneth O'Keefe. Behind him is the 3 of Joe Lettorello. Nathan Lamothe, good qualifier to be 5th on the grid here in the number 17 car, with Ronnie Krompus in 6th rather. Stephen Martin is in 7th with Botev 8th. The grid's going crazy. 9th is Nico Pantola, probably a bit further back than he would have liked to have been. 10th is Stefanov with Donalik 11th. Zlatev is in 12th with Konkradi in 13th. Eichelkamp is 14th with Pasjic in 15th. Angelov is 16th with Streeter rounding out the grid in 17th position. Stuart Baker is our safety car today. So, just yawn, there's a spinner in the background. Looks like Streeter's gone a bit excessive with his tyre warming. And coming to the line this time, they should actually get the one to green. There it is, safety car in this lap. Tyre warming needs to stop from all drivers and they need to get themselves double file for the start. And just as they're doing that, Nolan Scott, any predictions from you for this race?
Well, you know, I've been out of the loop for quite a while. Just to point on something you mentioned, Streeter actually has a little bit of right front damage, so that doesn't help his cause, but of course the next racing is going to win this baby, you know, that's right. Don't even play. No, but in all seriousness, I am out of the loop a little bit. I know Kent O'Keefe is going to be a big player. I know NX Racing is going to be a big player. You know, we'll just have to wait and see, but those are my two picks right now.
Yeah, well, they've looked good all the way through the practice sessions leading up to now, Robin in particular, so
yeah,
he is definitely one of the favorites for pole. Ken, I've not actually seen around too much through the practice sessions. I'm aware that he's done a few, and obviously I've just missed him. But Kenneth O'Keefe, always a massive player at the front. I mean, he's not won it before, but he's come so close so many times. And this twin 115 can be crucial to your race. If you can get yourself at the front and out of trouble when everyone's sorting themselves out early in the 250, it makes a world of difference. So finishing high up here is going to be key to everybody's success. And for people like Kenneth O'Keefe, who have come so close before, they'll be out there, angry elbows racing, trying to make that success theirs.
Well, Kenneth's definitely going to put out some angry elbows. He'll work for it, that's for sure. He's got a known history for that, and I'll be interested to see how he does this race, because I know he's going to fight for it.
Indeed, as Stuart Baker pulls off, safety car in. So here we go, grid getting themselves ready. The green flag going to be called by our race director, Jonathan Palmer, any second now. Nice, close, double-file formation coming to the green. There it is. Everyone's away. There's a bit of fanning out towards the back there. Good start from Robin Friskops, but Jarl Tyon seems to be getting a decent push from Joe Lettorello around the outside, so that might not last for long, although Kenneth O'Keefe is looking to get straight to the bumper of Friskops. Further back, three, almost four wide in some places, but everyone keeping themselves, relatively speaking, out of trouble. Plenty of room given throughout the field.
The front stayed extremely organized, and then back in the back we've still got some three wide action going on in the middle of the pack.
Here we do it. Oh, and here we are. Another element of the twin 115s, you must make a green flag pit stop and take four tyres during. So you've got a bundle of people going now. Interestingly, our top three have stayed out. So Friskops, O'Keefe and Tyan all stayed out there. So the first car to actually take this pit stop is going to be... Well, Nathan Lamothe is getting there first, but I think Joe Lettorello is actually the first car to hit the apron. And Nathan Lamothe's got a drive-through penalty. So that's throwing that one away for him. He's going to have to pray for a caution later in the race now, otherwise that is just game over for him.
Yeah, that's a shame because this is a big pack too, and that, they can definitely run a really quick pace with this many cars. So we're going to see what the leaders do. I'm sure that they want to come in early. That would be the strategy, I would think. It's been a long time since I've been here, but early was always the way to go, and I'm sure it will be this week too. Robin's coming into the pits. Looks like he's almost all alone there. I think there's a car in the back coming in with him.
He is looking like he's all alone, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. Pitting lap 2 is, generally speaking, quicker than pitting lap 1. But the problem is, of course, you can get cautions in that time. And if you've not pitted and there's a caution out with people that have pitted, you really end up on the back foot. Not surprising for me to see, though, is Yael Tyan and Kenneth O'Keefe joining together. Well, joining forces together, which I've seen them do so many times in this sim and others. Good friends, previous teammates, and... they know that they can bump well, and indeed they're going to bump well as they're going to be lapping most of the people that made pit stops on lap 1. Big surprise, and lapping them there, and in fact they're going to go to pit lane now. So as soon as they put that lap on people, they're going to dive to pit lane. They've used the bump on that lap, they'll probably even retain first if they are lucky. Sans, of course, the people that still have not pitted. Although I say that, and there's a big pack behind consisting of Botev, Krompus, Martin and Angelov, so that looks like everybody is now hitting pit road, and that will be everybody's green flag pit stops out the way, all thanks to a relatively clean start. So now I've got Robin exiting the pit lane. Interesting to see where he's going to come out. In fact, he's going to come out and he's going to pick up Joe Lettorello. If I was Joe, I'd just be lifting a bit, so you do pick up Robin. Those two have been working together well in practice sessions, and they'll want to work together well now. Joe's going to go to the inside and probably come back up in front of Robin as Nathan Lamothe has just gone and completed that drive-through that he got entering pit lane. So, back underway in pit lane. And Krompus, fantastic pit stop, was a good few lengths back from O'Keefe and Tyan going into pit lane, has managed to come out with them. So, good job there from Ronnie Krompus in the 96 car. A bit of beeping there as Kenneth O'Keefe cuts across his nose.
And just now, Robin and Lettorello are coming up. I think they're going to get the lead here.
They should. O'Keefe is out by himself. He's lost his draft partner in the pit lane. So, last of our pitters, number 83, on his way back out now, made his four-tyre stop. I'm concerned that because he had to do a bit of running by himself there, he is going to be losing out quite a bit here. In fact, it looks like he's going to come out in between the two major packs that we have at the moment. That could be an absolute disaster for him. In fact, if he doesn't pick up this second pack, it is going to be an absolute disaster for Stefanov in the 83.
And surprisingly enough, you are right, it's going to be a little bit close. He should be able to fall on the end of that second pack, though. Looks like he's going to catch it.
A big moment behind there for Stephen Martin. Looks like he got a bit of a lag tap on the bump to the car in front there. And a bit of contact there between Stefanov and Don Leek in the midfield. Good lap from Joe Lettorello there. So the bump already proving the quickest way around this track, a 47.80 from Joe Lettorello, and no doubt a similar time from Robin Friskops, who has actually fallen off the back of him there. So maybe that was from a bit of a lag tap and those two have split up. So it looks like we're actually going to, for at least a brief period, get six cars battling for the lead. Bump drafting pairs, it can work to a certain extent, but it's going to be difficult for them to pull off as a pack.
Yeah, appeared to be a little bit of an unlucky tap there because he's got a little bit more front end damage than basically any car on the track. And like you said, they had a pretty large gap for just a couple laps, and it tightened right back up in the course of half a lap. So something happened there.
Yeah, it must have been a dodgy tap, something that lots of people have been experiencing. The thing with the netcode and Live for Speed is, should either of you just get the smallest little latency drop or increase rather, then it can just tap you both off course. And if you're the car pushing, it's normally going to be you ending up worse off, as Friscops and Lettarello connect bumpers once again and try to get on the move, but I don't think they're going to be getting away from Tyne and O'Keefe quite so easily.
Those two leaders pair up, it is quite surprising how quickly they can stretch that gap. They're working really well together. That's not enough to solidify any kind of position, but they are able to stretch that out, which is fairly surprising.
Yeah, the advantage that they have is just how many of the practice sessions that they have done together. So they know each other's lines, they understand that they can draft together, that their ping for either one of them isn't too bad in relation to each other. So Robin and Joe going to work together here, and they do get along quite well. Robin obviously doesn't affect whether or not you get into the race here, but for Joe Lettarello, if he could actually take the win, or at least be first behind Robin Friscops, then be an absolute dream come true for him. In fact, that would actually put him on third position for the Kyoto 50. Is here to the inside, goes the run that I was expecting from Kenneth O'Keefe and Yael Tyne. Eichelkamp in the 16, keeping in tow too. Incredible lap there from Yael Tyne, and obviously the bump and then also the draft that they're getting from Krompus. Oh, not Krompus, rather, sorry, who am I talking about? Friscops in there, they've all got a bit mixed up there. In fact, looks like Eichelkamp's going to split Lettarello and Friscops. Lettarello's now just got to do his best to stick with Tyne and O'Keefe at the front.
Yeah, obviously a little bit of a traffic jam. Everybody wants to lead these laps, but a little aggressive this early on.
They are indeed. In fact, it looks like that second pack has bunched itself back up again. It spans about 10 cars at the moment, so I'll keep an eye and an ear on them, because I'm thinking if there's going to be a wreck, it could well come from that neck of the woods.
Lettarello given quite a bit of side draft in action here. He's actually scraped fenders quite a few times with that outside car. I don't know if he wanted to get down really bad.
Oh,
look there again.
Oh dear, that's what's going to happen if you try and do that with the netcode on Live for Speed. The side car gets you nothing, and you're just going to tap off him and lag into a wall.
Yeah, not using quite all the track right now. I don't know if he just wants to get aggressive and make a stake here, or what's going on here. But
what he wants to do is he wants to get to that bumper of Kenneth O'Keefe, and he's willing to get his elbows out and his hands dirty just to do so, which is exactly what he's doing. I mean, by tapping people like Joe on the side, you're not only threatening yourself going into the wall, but of course side-to-side contact means that you can tap them down the track and cause them to spin off. So unnecessary angry elbows there, as Robin Friscops had a very, very leery moment on the rear end. Obviously a bit of tapping from front and rear there for Robin Friscops, causing him to lose the rear end quite so quickly.
And what's interesting about this battle is Lettarello has split the group in front. He obviously wants to work with Robin, so they have a little bit of playtime there. And it's creating a lot of animosity in this front group. And then, you know, in fifth place, you've got the Dark Knight, who doesn't really have anybody to work with. So this is going to be really ugly for him, or it could be really good for him, because these leaders can take each other out.
Well, at the moment, they're scrambling so much that Krompus in the 96 behind is actually catching up. And there we have it, tying on to the bumper of Kenneth O'Keefe. And it's taken them a few laps to put it back together. It's exactly what they want to do. Joe Lettarello still showing his nose there, saying, don't think you're going to run off that easily, as he gets very, very sideways off of turn one and just about holds onto the draft of the two in front.
I was just getting ready to comment on how it seemed like he wasn't too flustered by giving up that position, and then the next corner he puts her sideways trying to show a nose to prove a point. This is going to be a good chance for Robin and him to pair back up, so I don't think he's real concerned. If anything, I think that's probably part of his plan, but can't let that gap get away from you too far.
No, indeed, there you have it. It looks like Robin and Joe are going to pair back up behind Yael Tyne and Kenneth O'Keefe and get themselves sorted out, back in line. Michael Camp, what he needs to do is not be bumping from behind. He just needs to stay in the draft. And I know for a fact that lots of drivers will have gone marginal on fuel, expecting a few more cautions than we have had so far, as Yael Tyne gets sideways, as does Robin Friscops. Couple of dodgy lag taps there for the both of them. So as the front two now are actually split up, the guys behind are still pushing. So this is going to bring those five back together again by turn three and probably through the exit and down the front stretch. Indeed it does. Joe Lettorello now right back under the bumper of Yael Tyne. Was Eichel Camp incredibly sideways? In fact, he's lost the draft. He is going to have to drop back to Krumpus if he wants to stay in the game at all on this one. So the battle at the front is about four, and we've got a spinner in three. Who's that who spun around in three? Now we've got, it's Conrad E, the 45, has taken a trip down onto the apron. It looks like he's actually been turned up into the wall there. Lots and lots of right side damage on that car, and in fact, he's going to go straight to pit lane to get it repaired. No caution called. I think that's probably because he went to the apron when he had his incident and no one else was taken out by it, but it's... Ooh, slow car in two, though.
That's Krampus.
Maybe Krampus had a moment.
It was just as soon as he was catching this number 16 car, and I figured that that would fall right into his hands and he would be able to finally catch that major group, but apparently not. No damage.
Maybe he went to give a bump and he was just, the speed differential was far too high and it spat him down the track a bit.
Quite well been the case.
Anyway, looking back to the front. These four still seemingly a bit racy for only 17 laps into this 62 lap race. As Yael Tyne goes very, very high in three, and in fact taps the wall and comes right down across the nose of Joe Lettorello.
Yeah, he is the pusher, and his tires are much hotter than the pushy Kenneth O'Keefe right in front of him. So apparently that car's starting to understeer quite a bit for him. He's burning up that right front.
Well, it
front.
Looks that way. In fact, he's not seen anyone wash up turn one that badly so far, but Yael Tyne really, really struggling.
Out of the top five, it looks like Lettorello has been the hardest on his right front out of that front group. But once again, he's been paired up right behind the cars in front of him. So there's basically no give or take for the second group right now until they want to pull out and make their own move. So I'm a little bit surprised to see Jarl's tire give out so much earlier than Lettorello's. But
well,
that seems to be the case.
You say Lettorello's tire is slightly hotter than Jarl's right front, and you're not wrong, but Yael Tyne has actually got quite a hot right rear. Maybe he's actually struggling from oversteer and having to chase that car up the track as opposed to be lifting off and slowing down to get the front to turn in.
And when you break it down to setup, it also looks like he's running a lot less camber. So I think he's actually putting a lot more mechanical force on that tire. But, you know, with that said, for me, I don't know what's causing him to push so bad. Maybe he's just running a little bit tighter car than anyone else. But I think he should be able to pull that back in because he's let his tire go off the last two laps now. And it should be within a good working temperature. So.
It should, and they are another big bump from all four of them again there. Surprised that there is no more lag involved. Normally you'd expect to see someone get squirrely when everyone taps together like that, but those guys are holding it together very, very well. You can see just how quickly you lose people when you lose the draft. Eichel Camp now a solid few seconds back down the road. In fact, 3.7 seconds behind Joe Lettorello, and it's only been two or three laps since he lost them.
Michael Camp is actually tapping his brake a little bit, trying to catch the group behind him. He's given up on the forward group. He's going to fall back in and get what he can out of this race. I would probably go ahead and run full out, because without a caution, you're probably never going to have a chance to catch the front runners either way. But, you know, with that said, it's a respectable call either way.
Indeed, he may well be treating it as further practice. It's always worth your time getting stuck in there and learning how the draft feels, drafting with different people and whatnot. But like you say, with a race of this length, and when everyone's spread out so well and we've not actually seen cautions so far, it's hard to see why you would actually drop back. It would be worth your time keeping your foot in it. Should probably hold position. Looking back to Eichelkamp, he's now been caught by the pack behind Nico Pantola, looks to the inside, takes that fifth position off him, and looks to get drafting with Eichelkamp. And then you've also got the 97 of Pasek. Fantastic drive there from Pasek, who started right the way at the back of the grid, currently up in 7th position in this battle for 5th place overall.
Yeah.
And at the front, we've had a separation. Yael Tine and Kenneth O'Keefe have broken themselves away from Robin Friscops and Joe Lessorello. So, could we now see these guys spread themselves out to such an extent that there is an obvious two that are going for the lead and an obvious two that are fighting over third?
I was under the influence. Lettarello and Robin might take a shot at the lead there, and maybe they're just biding their time, because, you know, once again, Lettarello's tire in comparison to Robin's is extremely hot, and Robin is actually the pusher of that group. So that's a little bit surprising. Maybe they're just biding their time. Maybe they want to get away from that draft a little bit. But Lettarello a little bit squirrely there through 1 and 2. So you know, who knows? That car may not be working real well for him right now.
It looks like he may have given the apron a bit much of a love tap there. Always unsettles the car through one if you do tap the apron, as Robin Friscops gets squirrely on the bump going towards three. Not a lot going on track at the moment, just a few little groups. Obviously you've got the two pairs at the front that are pushing, and then from there on back you get little groups of two, one, maybe even three drivers here or there. No one actually sort of trying to back themselves up so that they could draft with anyone else at the moment, just holding steady in most cases. And probably a good plan. I mean, you've got the race going green so far, provided you've got the fuel to make it to the end. That is definitely the best plan for you to take up.
Well, yeah, it is interesting you bring that up, because from 8th place all the way back to 16th, excluding 12th and 13th, you know, we're looking at one cars, you know, stacked together. There's a two-car group in 13th and 12th, and otherwise it's one cars all the way back, single group. So a little surprised to see these guys not pair up and try to, you know, maybe improve some positions, but maybe they are just trying to be safe and run some laps and get through this qualifier. There's a lot of time to make up out there. I mean, we've got groups back in 8th, 9th place, Martin, for example, who, if he could just pair up with someone, could really move up there into 5th, 6th place.
Indeed. I mean, obviously this gap to the front four is getting a bit difficult of a gap now, but the gaps between all the drivers from 5th on back, they're not really that substantial, excluding Conradi, who obviously had to make that extra pit stop. There's nothing there that's not bridgeable by a pair that would actually fall back and start working together for a few laps.
I mean, yeah, exactly. We basically got, it looks like 1.5 seconds per car, almost all the way back on average to almost 16th, excluding that 16th place driver. But there's a lot to make up out there. I'm surprised we're not seeing more. For example, Hockenkamp and Pantola just hooked up together, and they have totally left, what is his name? Pasek. Okay, well, thank you for the correction.
I'm probably mullering it too, so.
Regardless thereof, they paired up together and have pulled a sizable gap, so he should just fall back and pick up the 8th place driver and try to catch him back. Not seeing a whole lot of that.
Well, now's a good time to point out then, from Friscott, the only man in this race that is already qualified into the Kyoto 250. Besides him, it's going to be the top 11, and seeing as he is within that top 11, that stretches us back to the top 12. Final driver at the moment qualifying for the Kyoto 250 is Stefanov in the 83, back in 12th position, and he is not that far away from Angelov in 13th, so could well see some fireworks there before the end of the race, should Angelov get his foot down. Or rather, I mean, Zlatev's actually in the 53, is pulling up to the back of Angelov relatively quickly. If those two started bumping, they could not only push themselves into a position where Angelov qualifies, but they could push further than that and get them both in qualifying positions for the Kyoto 250. Two pairings at the front. Kenneth O'Keefe and Jaltine still seemingly a bit more comfortable with the pushing than the pairing of Joe Lettorello and Robin Friscott's just behind. Definitely setting fast laps at the moment, and looks like Jaltine has got his tyre situation well under control, whereas Joe Lettorello obviously still struggling a little bit with his tyres, and plenty of heat in that front right. That is going to be getting woeful pretty quickly.
Yeah, exactly. As you know, I've been out of the sport for a long time, but as soon as I start commentating any race, I like to look at tire data, and just a lot more camber from Robin. It seems like he's able to maintain that tire temperature a little bit better, but Robin and Lattarello's tires are much, much hotter than the front two of O'Keefe and Jarl. So, I don't know what's going on there, because they seem to be running a little bit slower pace, but they also seem to be panicking a little bit. It's getting to that stage that if they're not, I would be. So it's time to start asserting yourself back up to the front, hold that position, because if it goes green, you want to be in contention to win this, and they need to start making their move now. You know, go ahead and get up there, make a statement. And I don't think they're able to do it. I think from the looks of it, it looks like they're pushing as hard as they absolutely can.
Does indeed. Last lap did see Kenneth O'Keefe and Jaltine separate just a little bit, allowed that gap between the two pairings at the front to come down, but like you say, I can just see Robin really making far too much of an effort to stay on the rear of Joe through the corners, and I think that's just losing them both time. You'll find that with Kenneth O'Keefe and Jaltine further forward, that they're giving each other plenty of room through the corners. They know that they can't bump there and gain time. They're actually just setting up the bumps even better for the exits, and that is working absolutely perfectly for them. Further back, and we're actually seeing some pretty impressive lap times get churned out by the pairing of Eichelkamp and Pantola in the 16 and 87 respectively. That's the battle for fifth position on track. A solid few seconds, and by a few seconds, I mean 7, if not 8 seconds or other, behind that top 4. So, massive, massive gap there, but these two getting a lot of valuable data and experience from pushing each other around the track and setting times as they are, also keeping themselves well out of any bother that may well kick off behind them.
Yeah, that's true, and just to illustrate that pace, Pantola actually has a faster lap than Robin or Lattarello, so he's got a quick race car.
Didi does. Like I said prior to the race, I was surprised that Nico Pantola wasn't actually starting further up the grid. I know that on these ovals he has got a lot of pace, particularly in the XRT. So he must have just had a slightly dodgy qualifying, and now he's moved his way forward, and he's working with someone and working with them very well. Eichelkamp, in fact, having a fantastic showing as well here. Obviously put in the practice necessary. He is, I believe, the highest running rookie. I lied, that's Joe Lettorello. Joe Lettorello is the highest rookie at the moment. It's always easy to forget that Joe, fairly new to LFS, despite feeling as though he's been around for quite a while now. Eichelkamp too, new to this format, the oval racing, and doing a fantastic job of it.
Yeah, Nico Pantola actually won the 250 in 2012.
The 500.
Oh, the 500.
Yeah, he won the 500 in the formula, V8. Which is a good job. I'm not well versed in how that race actually went in the end, but I think Nico was pretty much the king of strategy in placing his car at the right times last year in the 500, and as such ended up winning that race on the day. So, like I said, we know he's got pace and ability around the Kyoto Oval on Lifter Speed, and at the moment he is showing us exactly what that pace and ability is by pushing Eichelkamp nearly perfectly around the track, lap in, lap out.
Well, that's right. You know, I've been away from the sport for a long time, and you know, Nico was always a solid competitor in the you know, the late teens, you know, 2009, 2010, when I basically quit. And I am a little bit surprised to see him not up towards the front. Their pace is extremely strong, though. Let's not forget that. I mean, they are running an extremely quick lap time on average. Eichelkamp in my old 16 number, so I'm kind of rooting for him, to be honest with you. But a little bit surprised to see Nico not a little bit further up. I was unaware that he won the 500. A little bit miscommunication on my part. But, yeah, just an all-around great oval driver. So I think he'll pair a little bit better in the 250 when it actually...
As our leader come across a bit of lap traffic here, and Comrade not really giving them miles and miles of room to work with, but just enough for the two to pull underneath him and get their race on further. Yeah, Comrade now moves high and out of the way, giving plenty of room. Only a smidgen of time lost there, really, for Tyne and O'Keefe. It didn't faze them all that much at all, and Comrade looking to get back in the draft, and I think he's got it for now. It'll be good for him to hold that draft and maybe try and make a move to the front just in case there is a caution. Although, in all fairness, he is going to be the only guy lapped out, so it wouldn't matter. He would get the lucky dog anyway should a caution come out.
And Nathan Lamothe in 16th is a long way up the road, so you shouldn't feel a lot of urgency to stay with the leaders, but probably wouldn't be a bad idea just in case.
Yeah, in fact, it looks like he's dropped off the back of the leaders there, so not ideal for him, but at the same time, like we say, he would get the lucky dog anyway by quite some margin, because Nathan Lamothe in 16, not under any pressure of being lapped anytime soon. So, battle towards the back of the positions that are going to be locked in. 11th and 12th, the 46 of Botev and 83 of Stefanov. They've just gone and switched around as I have given you those names and numbers. Both these guys rookies, both of them qualified in at the moment. No real need for them to start getting feisty with each other because they're both qualified in 11th and 12th. If they take each other out, and Botev slams himself into the wall there, should they take each other out, then that's just going to open the floodgates for anyone else behind them to go and nick a position and qualify themselves in any way. And so far as I'm aware, Botev and Stefanov didn't have the strongest of qualifying, so they're not in the best of positions to be wanting to sit back on the qualifying time they set to get in through the final six, which are the drivers that don't qualify through qualifying by either getting pole or second and do not finish in the top 11. You then get the six next fastest qualifiers to fill up the back few rows of the grid, a fate that I was subject to back in 2010 when I made my debut in the 250. Nathan Lamothe not in any real trouble. He was in the 47s. That surprising number of drivers in the 47s this year. Normally you only see one or two. This year the competition absolutely huge, as we see Streeter in the 49 rubbing against the wall as Nathan Lamothe makes his way past for 15th position. So, carry on.
Oh, Nathan's a guy we haven't talked about a lot, but once again, just another strong oval guy. Even back when I was running, 2010, 2009, and I've heard that he's stretched that skill set of his out, and he's become even better. And yeah, he definitely he's got a car with a pace that he shouldn't even have to worry about this qualifier to get into the 250.
Indeed, and Nathan Moth, one of those drivers that over the past few years in Lifter Speed, we could really describe him as a development driver or just a driver in development. Wasn't the fastest guy when he came in, but now definitely a force to be reckoned with when he's out on the tracks. He's always got pace that's worthy of being up there with the top guys. So again, it's a nice story to see where someone does start, maybe not as the quickest driver, but puts in the effort, puts in the practice over the years, and now definitely up there when it comes to events, particularly these ones on the ovals, which he is akin to loving to bits.
Just to go back to the front real quick, Latarello and Robin have caught the lap car, and it looks like they're... Oof! Robin just almost spun out, but looks like he's going to let them go as well. Hopefully he'll just fall in behind and try to ride that out. I wouldn't want to lose any more positions than I had to, but I would definitely want to stay with that front pack, because if they catch the other lap car of Lamoth, then he actually has a chance to overtake that driver and get his lap back. So definitely in his interest to stay with this lead pack if he can. He may or may not be aware of that, so we'll watch him for the next couple laps, but he did give that position up fairly easily.
He didn't. It looks like he's trying to hold on to the rear bumper of Robin Friskops at the moment. But then again, we did see just how quickly that went wrong for him when he tried to do the same to O'Keefe and Tyne up front. In fact, it looks to be going wrong again. Comrade already out of the draft of Friskops and Lettorello.
Yeah.
Lettorello, going through turn one, has to be so wide on entry. His tyres must be absolutely screaming for help right now. They have cooled down, but I think the tread may well be on its way down as well. So he's going to have a few laps here where the grip's actually going to start coming back to him. So we could see the times for Lettorello and Friskops gradually begin to tumble as Friskops gets lag tapped into the wall again. These two obviously not getting the tango quite as good as they've managed to in the past today. And what a time to have it not go right for you, because this is one of those races that counts, particularly for Joe Lettorello.
Yeah, just a lot of bad luck I've seen from this group. Even when they were going around the back marker just last lap, a big tap going through the trial wall, almost lost it, Robin did. And then again, the next lap, it's just a lot of connection issue right there between those two drivers.
Yeah, indeed there was. Maybe it's not quite the right partnership, but of course they're now in a position where they don't have a great deal of choice over who they're bumping with. So, unlucky for those two, but obviously running in third and fourth respectively is not the worst place to be.
Nah, absolutely. You stole the words out of my mouth. I should be completely satisfied with this result.
Interestingly, looking back to ninth position, Stephen Martin and Ronnie Krompus, as opposed to bumping each other, are absolutely duking it out, going side by side pretty much every corner and have been doing for the past few laps. These guys going at it and allowing Stefanov, who is running by himself in 11th, to catch up. And in fact, Stefanov has lost Botev, who is very, very slowly falling into the grasps of Zlatev. And that's a big one to call, because if Zlatev gets past, that is for the final qualifying position in this race. And there we go, Zlatev, brilliant turn three, right on the bumper of Botev. This is where the battle is at now. The final qualifying position in this twin 115 for the Kyoto 250, and we've got Zlatev and Botev going at it, and they no doubt will be going at it properly as soon as someone from their team gets down the radio to them saying this is for a position that's somewhat more important than you might think it to be. They are going to start taking chunks out of each other, or what Zlatev's doing at the moment, the mature choice, which is to push up to the guys in front, and by doing so that gives you even more opportunity to qualify in by opening up more positions for you to take that are within those qualifying position ranges.
Yeah, exactly. Put somebody else in your own shoes. Let them have to deal with it. And judging by the looks of it, they could definitely catch the car in front. They've got plenty of time to do so, it looks like.
Yeah, Stefanov not turning particularly stunning times all by himself at the moment, so he will no doubt get swallowed up. Martin and Krompus tripping over each other. They're setting even slower times up in 9th and 10th position. So for these guys to team up now, it's a difficult call for Zlatev to make, because of course if you've got the quicker car, you could just nip your nose in front and run away with the position that you need. But what he's doing now, very, very good call, I think, because you're just going to make it easier for yourself and the guy you're pushing to take those potential spots in the Kyoto 250 without having to concern yourself with your qualifying time. And like I say, these guys further back, none of them with particularly stunning ones, so they are going to want to be finishing in the right places.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you go to the cars up front, like Martin, for example, you know, there's a guy with a ton of oval experience. And I don't know if it's just that Krumpus doesn't want to work with him, or he doesn't want to, I don't know what the situation is, but they need to pair up together, because you know, once again, those two cars behind her are quite a distance back. But I mean, there's no sense in racing like this. I feel like I'm watching a NASCAR race. You know, pair up, let's run out the laps, and then at the end, let's fight for it. But apparently, they don't want to do so.
No, with 17 laps to go, and they're setting, I'd say 48.3s, 48.4s when they're swapping positions like this and compromising lines. And they're going to be very, very quickly into the 47s back in 12th and 13th with their bumping. And with the gap that's there, that can't really be any more than 6 or 7 seconds, over the following 17 laps that there are remaining in this race, they will catch up and they will take those positions if you continue to fight. So, not the time for them to be doing that. And in fact, Martin looks as though he's actually broken away from Crompus now. So, it could be a saving grace for a few of them if Crompus and Stefanov choose to work together and push away from the guys charging behind. Then Zlatev is going to have to start rethinking his strategy and pushing himself into the 11th spot, the 12th spot rather, so that he can take that net 11th spot into the Kyoto 250 itself.
Yeah, I mean, you weigh the good with the bad. You know, Crumpus just got into the outside wall out of the final corner. You know, once again, just pushing really hard, trying to stay in front of Martin there. And with what's at stake here, with as far back in the field as you are, you know, it's usually you would want to lead to a more conservative race style at this point in the race. So a little bit surprising. You know, it's good. It's entertainment for us, but at the same time, from a engineering standpoint, you might want to just back off on your pace a little bit.
Oh, and Kenneth O'Keefe.
Oh, he now, just engaged his nose.
No, but that's an illegal chat during the race session. There's the drive-through. Kenneth O'Keefe with the drive-through at this stage in the race. Absolute disaster. And no doubt sighs of relief from Friskovs and Letterello behind.
Well, it's going to open
disastrous.
The door. Exactly. It's going to open the door for Robin and Letterello, you know, to catch the leader, number one. And number two, Kenneth O'Keefe, man, that's got to be heartbreaking for him. You know, he loves to win. That's what he wakes up for. And he wanted to win this race. And anyway, that's got to be a kicker.
There we go. And Tyon continuing by himself. Right now, he's going to feel ever so slightly vulnerable with a charging pair of Letterello and Friskovs behind. Those guys, I imagine, are probably going to find a couple of tenths a lap now, having seen Kenneth O'Keefe get the drive through just through the boost in morale that they're going to get. So Jarl Tyon now is the guy who's going to be in trouble in no time whatsoever. In fact, he's got a healthy lead. He's got 5 seconds on them. It depends how quickly Jarl Tyon can lap from now on. If it's not all that quick, then he'll get eaten up. But if he can lap quickly, then he might just about get away with it.
Well, that's a good point. That is a little bit larger gap than I had anticipated. Let's check those paces here in a couple laps, and then we'll know. I mean, we're getting down to 12 to go this time by. So it's going to be close. It really is. The interesting thing for me is where Kenneth is going to come out, because obviously he has the pace that, regardless thereof, he's probably going to qualify into the 250. But he's going to be right back there in that battle for the final spot. He's going to be probably back 9th, 10th position. We'll see where he comes out.
Yeah, he's come out 9th, and that's just ahead of the now battle between Crompus and Stefanov, those two not working together. Kenneth O'Keefe will no doubt be looking for someone to push and or get pushed by so that he can at least finish further up than where he is at present. But these guys looking like they don't want to work, so it's more likely to be a case where he's just going to get embroiled in a battle that's going on, and a big leg tap there from Kenneth O'Keefe on Stefanov to push him through. Looks like Kenneth has chosen who he's working with and is going to get his nose up the bumper and get pushing.
Yeah, we all know Kenneth. I think he's still got it in the back of the mind that he's got a chance to win this race if he gets a caution. So he's definitely going to want to try to push somebody. But like you said, I don't know what it is with this group back here in the back, but just don't really want to work with each other very much. It's a little odd almost. They almost look out of place. But a little bit of contact there with O'Keefe down on the bottom. But if they just pair up, this would work out pretty well. But man, it doesn't look like this is going to happen for O'Keefe. Just a little bit of an update at the front. Jarl, our leader, our race leader right now, is losing quite a bit of time. It looks like 3 tenths by, 6 tenths by, and then 2 tenths by that last time. And this time by... just looking at about 2:10, so that's still a pretty good pace from our leader. So Robin and Laterella are going to have to step it up just a little bit to catch up. Speaking of which, Robin and Laterella, just to give you a little bit more info, are in the 47.9s that last time by. Their best lap is in the 47.6s, so there's definitely some pace there for them to make up if they can do it. Is a unique update from race control there, the 83 Stefanov. I just came in for a green flag pit stop. Not quite sure why. Could be fuel related. Didn't change tires or anything like that, but had to be fuel related for that matter. Banking on a caution, I guess. Does kind of dampen the race at the end. Looks like the gap for that position, that final position into the qualifier, is going to be quite wide now. Amazing pace from Jarl at the front. That time by on the split sector, 16.75. The pair behind drafting front to rear with a 16.74. I mean, there's almost no difference there, so I don't see these two drivers catching our leader.
No, it really doesn't look like that. At the line, there are 2:10. Hello from me now here. Just filling the void of some Oscar who went away.
Some slacker commentator.
So to speak, yeah.
He put the pressure on me, let's be honest. But now back to all seriousness. Just looking at the pace, like you said, there's not much there. And then Laterello just pulled a big gap from Robin Friskopf's there. So, it looks like they're pushing really hard. They're trying to make up time. But it looks like it's coming with a little bit of a price right now.
Still faster, but there are 3.4 seconds left to time. And we just have 7 laps? 8 laps? 8 laps left. So I don't think that's going to work out for them.
And does not appear so. The pace from the second group just isn't what I was quite expecting. I mean, just as an example, I just had a quick look back at our one-time race leader, Kenneth O'Keefe, just to give you an update on how his race is going to turn out. He just made a pass for 8th position and ran all the way down in the 47.5s. So, the pace from second and third isn't quite there. Oh, and a big crash!
There's been a wreck. Oh, where's that? And the safety car's out. Oh, goodness, no!
I told you, Kenneth O'Keefe was never doubting winning this race.
I apologize for my sudden absence, but I have returned just in time for the drama.
Perfect timing.
So that blows it wide open, because this caution is going to be over before the end of the race. So there's going to be a dash for the line. Kenneth O'Keefe might actually be thinking, hold on just 1 minute, I'm not in this one yet.
That's what I said. I knew he's licking his chops right now. As soon as he got that drive through, he was thinking it's all part of my plan. I knew he was never going to give up on this win, and he moved himself all the way up into eighth place. You know, that's kind of important to point out because he was pretty much all alone because Krumpus and can't remember who the other driver was that was with him didn't really want to work with him. So he made all that time up by himself. Exactly. Thank you. But yeah, Steve Martin a little bit unlucky there with just a big lag tap and. Spun him around on the backstretch there.
Oh, and Steve Martin had a moment all by himself just there.
And when it rains, it pours.
Pit entry's been opened. I can't see anybody using it, to be honest.
At this point in time, it doesn't seem like it'd be very necessary. This is going to give... Jarl even got me. I'm not even in the race, and he faked me out. Wow. How dare he?
49, blinkers on, in neutral. Is that out of fuel?
Well, the motor does appear to be off. It is.
Of Stefanov, getting the lucky dog, gets to pass everybody and grab his lap back. Gonna put him into some pretty healthy contention for a position into the Kyoto 250.
This is two times now that we've seen a little bit of odd fuel consumption numbers. Streeter does appear to be out of gas. He's not firing up his motor. He's going slow enough now that regardless thereof, he would do so. He's getting a push from our RB4. And that's twice this race we've seen people either pit or run out of gas due to fuel mileage.
Indeed. An odd one to see. I mean, like I said, lots of people would have gone much closer than you need to, simply because they're expecting more cautions. The fact that the first caution comes out on lap 56 of 62 will be a surprise to pretty much everybody involved.
That is very true. I was always of the mentality, though, that, you know, I would rather have a little too much as not enough. And that's definitely it's not a big mistake for Streeter, because at least it did happen under caution. But, you know, that he would have went one lap more on under green flag, he would be a lap down, and he would not be our lucky dog. So that's, you know, as a matter of fact, he may already be a lap down. If not, he's going to go a lap down right now.
He's already one lap down. He's going to be another lap down as
exactly.
They come past this time. So, seeing as we are within 10 laps of the finish, there is no inside line that's going to be made available for cars a lap down. They are all going to be shuffled to the back so that the guys that are on the lead lap can duke it out for the final positions. Yeah, interesting little pointer that we're getting through our ears from the TV director. Stephen Martin and Nathan Lamoff all the way down in 13th and 14th, just outside of the qualifying positions for the Kyoto 250. Both very, very quick, very, very capable drivers. So, should these two get their act together and stop having quite as much bad luck as they have done so far this race, they could well push themselves forward, not just to a qualifying position, but also to a very, very good position. We saw prior to the caution that there are only really three groups that did want to bump draft each other, and that was Tyne and O'Keefe, and obviously that one got split up. Priskov, Slettarello, and then you also had Eichelkamp and Pantola all working together. So should these two choose to work together, they could very well push themselves right the way up the grid. And it looks like we've actually had the restart board out, so we are going to be going green this time by. And the leader, I believe, controls the pace. The leader at the moment is Jarl Tyne. He knows what... He knows what he's doing. He's now holding on the brake. He is spooling up the turbo, holding on the brake, foot flat down on the accelerator in third gear. Just getting ready for a launch when he is ready. When is that launch going to come? Any second now. There it is. He has pushed himself off. Got a nice little jump on Joe Lettorello. The green flag is called. Further back, no one making any notable moves, minus Lamoth and Martin. There you are. We called it just prior to the start. They're going to the outside. They're pushing around the outside of people already. Getting their heads down, getting towards those qualifying positions for the Kyoto 250 so they don't have to come in on their qualifying times, which I'm sure they would have done had they not been in a position to qualify in through the race. I'm going to make it three wide through the middle here with Krompus on the outside, Botev on the inside, Krompus having just to check out the track a bit, and Patola's very sideways up ahead. A horrible leg tap there, and he's still smashing into the side of Pasich in the 97. Huge moment, lucky to get away with it, and that has actually foiled Kenneth O'Keefe's plans of moving further forward than he was. He had to get right out of the gas.
Look at that though, Kenneth O'Keefe down on the bottom with some contact on the outside. He's going to make up some ample positions here.
Nico Patola wants very to dicey further back. White flag's given, and we've got Lettorello and Friskops moving to the outside of Tyne. And Friskops has gone all sideways, so Tyne's going to just nip in there on the inside. Is he going to be able to hold it together just about? I imagine Lettorello's not going to give him the draft, though. Lettorello's going to hold on the outside, let Friskops come back up to him. It is these three for the lead. It's going to keep with them for now. So he's going to take this one. Friskops can obviously win the race just for a bit of extra glory, but does not need to. He is into the race. These two are battling for third position on the grid, and they're going to go three wide into the final corner of the race. Who's it going to be? Tyan just taps Lettorello, and Lettorello's into the wall. So Friskops has got the run to the line now. Tyan just in behind him.
Can he hold it?
Tyan's
going
to go to the
it?
Outside. He's got a decent run here. Is Friskops going to push him up to the wall? No, Friskops is going to keep it in low. This is going to be very, very close going to the line, and it's going to be Tyan who takes it. Tyan by a couple of hundredths. Further back, Pasich just about beats Kenneth O'Keefe to the line. That was pretty much a photo finish for them. Nico Pantola has managed to come home in seventh. Missed a few guys out there. In eighth is Stephen Martin. Good little run forward from him. Ninth was Krompus, Lamoth 10th. So those guys both pushed forward to get themselves qualified in fine.
That was a beautiful push from Steve Martin and Pantola there. You know, we were talking about how they were going to move up. Not only did they move up, they got seventh and eighth. That's going to be a good position for them. Kenneth O'Keefe worked his way up to sixth. I mean, Kenneth pretty much worked all by himself that entire last run and made it all the way up to sixth. He got two positions there. Those are two very important positions. So, you know, good job from those three.
Really, really, really fantastic job. Big news really from the Twin 115, 46 finishing in 12th position. That is the last spot that qualifies you into the 250 without having to go back onto your time. So people not qualified in on this race, so not racing their way into the Kyoto 250, is Angelov in 13th, the number 22, Zlatov 14th in the 53. Zhifanov, after having been so high up early on, only finishes in 15th position in the number 83 car. Conradi finishes 16th. Obviously, he had an incident earlier on in Streeter, multiple incidents, quite slow all day, finishing in last position back in 17th place. All in all, a very, very exciting race, and all that drama at the end there provided us with an absolutely stunning finish. Well deserved there from Yeltsin to pull it back despite not having anyone to work with right at the end. Good job from him. Good job from Joe Lettorello as well to keep himself at the front. Eichelkamp, fantastic. He was there all racing fourth and he held on to it. So good job all round. Some guys are going to be much happier than others with the qualifying. Kenneth O'Keefe did make the best of a bad thing there, moved himself forward, but would have hoped to have been at the front, to be perfectly honest. That's where he's used to being in these oval races. And he's going to have to start himself from, I believe, 11th position when it comes to race day itself.
It's a good recovery from Kenneth, regardless, and a stellar race all around. I mean, we've got 15 cars finished on the lead lap. Two cars did not. Just turned out to be a fantastic finish.
Indeed it was, and a relatively clean race as well. The one caution in 62 laps you see so very rarely in these races. These guys today put on a good show, a very clean show. We only saw a couple of spins early on. And then obviously that unfortunate lag tap for Stephen Martin brought out the caution on 56. But these guys really did hold it together very well. No wrecks coming to the line. Fantastic job from everybody involved.
Yeah, and keep in mind that the one caution we did have from Martin was due to a massive lag tap. So no fault of his own. I think the only real spin we saw was from Conrady and Streeter before the race even started. So good, yeah, it was a good group of drivers.
Indeed it was. I think on that note, it's going to be worth us wrapping up this one. Well, I personally won't, but you'll have Nolan Scott and I believe Thilo Falkenberg. No, not Thilo Falkenberg. You'll have Nolan Scott with you in a few moments. But myself and Thilo, we're going to be in race two. Of course, there is another race coming up where we're going to have the top 11 once again racing their way into the 250. I believe it's going to be Hall in the, I forget the number, I think it's 93 car that Hall has got.
So that leaves 32. Me alone for the next commentary race?
I believe it does.
Well, that means I'm going to have to call it a day. You gentlemen have a wonderful evening. No, I'm just kidding. I'll be here for the second race, so take a break. Good luck in your race, and we'll talk to you shortly. We'll get an interview with you afterwards.
Indeed. Well, thank you very much. Thank you guys for watching so far. Fantastic race one. Can race two match it in terms of outright awesome? See you in a moment.
What? Hi, and welcome back to the Kyoto 250 qualifiers. Getting ready for race two. We're going to try to get a couple drivers in here for interviews before we start, so bear with us. Oh, and here's one of them now. Jarl, a race winner from race one. I'd like to ask you a couple questions. Number one, how'd you make it happen, man? You and Kenneth were up there pretty much making a name for yourself, and then when Kenneth got that drive-thru, I thought you might have been caught, and somehow you managed to win the race. How did it unfold those last couple laps?
Well, sadly, Kenneth got a drive-thru, so I was pretty much alone for the last few laps, but then the caution came out, and pretty much then I decided to go balls out, or balls deep, and I didn't care where I finished, so I don't know. Three wide on the last lap. I got kind of lucky, pretty much.
Yeah, we definitely saw that. As soon as that caution came out, it was kind of putting you back, and then out of nowhere, you just charged right through the front, right through both of them. Secondly, what do you think it's going to take to win this next race? I mean, we were expecting a couple more cautions. We were looking at more of a strong, quick pace, and tire management actually seemed to play a factor in that race. Is that something that you think is going to be a big factor in the second? Is it something that you plan your setup around, or is that not important?
I don't think tire wear is that important. It's more tire heat and controlling your tire heat, not going above something like 80. Because in race one, my tires were peaking at 81, and I was struggling. But pretty much, if you want to finish solid, you just need to be patient and don't push it. Just get it into the finish.
So in retrospect, in the 250, is tire wear going to be a concern there, being a little bit longer race? Probably not, I would imagine. But what's your insight on that?
I would believe, yeah. But we would expect more cautions in yellows, so we would be able to switch tires. But if we went green over 80 laps, 90 laps, tire wear could become a tough problem.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting factor in the race. But, yeah, I was interested with Kenneth's comment there in the race. You know, you got that drive-through for those that aren't aware from a spam of, I guess, a bound key, one of his function keys. It was /engage, or !engage, excuse me. What was that all about? I mean, did he allude to what might have caused him to press that?
I have no idea what he was doing, but it wasn't intentional, for sure.
Well, now, I would hope not, unless he's just trying to show off there. But that caution came at the right time for him, and I was telling everybody on the broadcast, I said, he's fully thinking about winning this race. He thinks he can contend. So,
yeah.
You know, it played out for him there at the end. He had a nice little run, and I didn't know, you know, what would happen if he got to the front, if you guys would try to pair back up. But obviously it worked out well for you. So unless you have anything to add, I appreciate your time. We're getting ready to go green here in just a couple minutes for race two. So fantastic finish. Good job.
Thanks.
All right, everyone, we're about to grid the field here in just a moment. That was Jarl Tien, our winner from race one. Joining me in the commentary booth for race two is Steve Martin. So, hey, Steve, how was your race, by the way?
Hey, it was pretty tricky. I was with a few other guys, but dropped off, and I spent most of the race on my own, and then caused the only caution by having a bad contact with the back of Kenneth O'Keefe, trying to bump draft. But this happens. But I managed to get up to eighth in the finish, and I'm okay with that. It's an okay starting position for the 250.
Yeah, there's no sense in stressing over that. I saw you and it was Nico Pantola, correct, hooked up and really kind of set sail there on that last run.
Yeah, we were really getting together. Me and Nathan the Moth, on the restart, he was giving me a bump, and then me and Nico were together And I gave him a push to the line to try and catch the group of cars in front, but it wasn't to be.
Yeah, it's a good recovery either way. Well, our drivers for race two are on their formation lap. P. Hall starting on the pole. Ran a great lap in the qualifier just beforehand. Keep in mind, though, he is already locked into the race. Second place, I know I'm going to mispronounce this. Widowars, I believe it is. I have no idea how to pronounce that name. Starting in second, Kapal in third, Hardwick in fourth, Majur fifth. Sixth, we have Fernandez. Seventh, Corinne. And in eighth place, we have Shepard further on back the field. We'll get to those drivers as we go along, but it looks like we're possibly going to go green this time by.
I know, it's next time by.
Yeah, you're correct. Blauhoff, a familiar name back in ninth place. Kingsbury status, and another Kingsbury. Are those two related by any chance? Is anyone aware of that?
They are. They are related, yeah. They're brothers.
Corns further on back. Harmon, Goga, Kagakis, and Falkenberg running out the end of the field. A little bit surprised to see Falkenberg back there from the years past. He's been pretty quick. Did he have a botched 250 lap? Hey, you're no help. I know. Figured out how to read the LFS overlays. We are going to go green this time by. Safety car is in. Hall has control of the field. Let's see if we get a nice clean start here. Nice controlled start from Hall as he starts the second race of the Kyoto 250 qualifiers for 2013.
It's a very good start from Hall. He's way out on his own at the moment, coming to turn one. And they're three wide behind him. Things just got to try and settle down as we get through this first lap and we see who's going to dive into the pits and not.
Yeah, with that big gap from Hall, it might be a good time to go ahead and dive down, take the gap, even though it is a little bit slower.
He's not coming in, he's staying out. He's all on his own and he's got quite a large lead already.
Yeah, I got a large group coming out of the pits, a little bit larger than the first race. I believe we had seven the first time. I don't know, we might have, it looks like about nine or ten cars this time in, so a little bit larger group. Hardwick leading that group into the pit lane. Yeah, meanwhile, the other group that stayed out is quite spread, actually. Hall with a big lead. As our first group leaves the pits, our second group comes in. Everyone on track except for Corns, as a matter of fact. Paul leads that group in. Hardwick, first in, first out. Gonna round out the second, or the first group to the front, and we'll see where they all fall in line.
It's so important for these guys not to make a mistake such as speeding in the pits, because a drive-through will really cost you. I can't recall who it was who got a drive-through in the first race.
That was Nathan.
Yeah, and that can really destroy your race. You don't want to get a penalty this early on. But so far, everyone's avoiding that mistake.
Yeah, that's a good point to bring up, because Nathan Lamont got that penalty last time, and as you may or may not know, run around at the back of the field for the rest of the race until the caution, and ended up getting a decent finishing position, but because of that, which there's really no reason for with the groups packed up the way they are, but it happens. And now that we're watching the main group leave the pit, or the second group leave the pits, they're going to fall in line a little bit ahead of Hardwick, our leader from the first group. But all in all, it looks fairly well spread across the whole field. Hall is still with that demanding lead, but he's all alone, and Hardwick and Kapal are paired up.
Cameron Corns, the last driver to pit, is just approaching pit exit. Now he's going to be pretty much at the back of the pack.
Yeah, that did definitely not work out in his favor. Just getting a report now that Corns actually missed his first pit entry, missed his stall. Had to move forward a little bit, lost a little bit extra time that way. Of opposite of what we saw in the first race, a little bit more spread at the front. We've got a tight pack at the rear, fighting for that last transfer spot. Hall out front, really showing the strength of that car. I mean, all alone, obviously off the pace compared to the two cars behind, but still lapping extremely quick times. Hardwick and Kapal pulled in about 3/10 that last time by, so they will catch Hall. But once again, strong car all around from Hall. He's really showing why he put that car second on the grid for the 250.
Indeed, he's made a strong start to this twin race, but what he's got to focus on now is how he's going to deal with Kapal and Hardwick coming up behind him, how he's going to use them to stay ahead, who, if he's going to pick one of them to work with, who is he going to work with?
Yeah, the question is where does the alliance lie with the two behind him? Because if there's not a strong alliance there, he may try to break it up. He may just try to fall to the back and ride it out to the end of the race. But obviously, Hall is pretty much left out to dry for the time being, unless he can get one of these two to break.
Dude, it looks like Hardwick doesn't want to use Hall at all. Just wants to go straight past him, which he does, and into the lead. Kapal second and Hall third.
Yeah, if I were in their shoes, I would do the same, because Hall, really, really quick race car, not taking anything away from the other two, but did really show his strength in that qualifier, so I would want to try to get out in front and hold my alliance where I could, and or where I was, excuse me, and ride it out to the end of the race. I think Hall is going to be content there. I mean, he obviously looks like he's just going to fall in line and ride it out, which, in my opinion, would be the smart thing to do. A little bit further back, we've got a great battle for 6th through 9th. Two sets of cars, two wide, they're splitting each other constantly.
Yeah, we got Shepherd and Matt Kingsbury, who have managed to get themselves ahead of Blauhoff and Ray Kingsbury. They were side by side through turn 1, but Shepherd and Matt have managed to get themselves in front. They're going for 6th at the moment. Blauhoff is in 8th. At present, they're going to try and not lose too much ground to the guys, not try not to let them get away.
Oh, and we have a timeout.
Timed out.
Yeah, exactly. That's a terrible shame.
He was around about the last transfer spot at the time as well.
That is a shame. That's early on. I mean, any time in the race, but you know, just to go back to that battle we were looking at just a little bit earlier, Shepherd and Kingsbury pulling away just a little bit from Blauhoff and his brother Kingsbury, and they are catching them. And they are catching the two cars in front of them. 23 car has apparently spun. Oh no, that's Goga in the 44 car.
And he was in 12th place in the final transfer spot at the time. Which, that's not the right way to hold on to that position, for sure. He spun coming out of turn 3. And now he's a long way back.
And that actually puts Corns in our final position to transfer. Final transfer position, who earlier on just missed his pit stall. So, you know, this is turning out to be a nice little comeback already. Only on lap 11 for Gorns.
Meanwhile, Shepherd and Matt Kingsbury continue their charge. They've batched over Major and Rodriguez. I have no idea how it's pronounced, I apologise. They've gotten past and making it look easy, basically. And they're up to 4th place now.
Yeah, that is a difficult name. I believe it's Puttawars. I don't believe that, but that's how I'm going to pronounce it for the time being. But yeah, absolutely, Shepherd and Kingsbury showing a pretty good pace here, working together quite nicely. They just pretty much flew past those two. And Blauhoff and Ray Kingsbury, his brother, is not able to maintain that kind of pace, and that's becoming quite evident because they are almost losing this four car draft in front of them. Group of cars all over the track right now, you know. We've got a little bit of a spin at the back, it looks like. Ray Kingsbury is off. Oh, and there's a safety car. Somewhat questionable safety car, but that's definitely going to pack the field back up. And Ray looks like he has a little bit of damage, nothing substantial, just body work, but definitely fired up those tires on that spin.
Kingsbury's spin has dropped him back to that final transfer spot.
Yeah, that is quite a shame. I'm trying to get a little bit more feedback on what might have caused that spin. I don't know if it was caught on the broadcast or not, but we're going to try to get some more info on that and allude to what might have caused that accident.
we're under our first caution and the pits are now open. Let's see if anyone takes the opportunity to do so. Shepard thinks about it, but decides against it.
Shepard got me too. That's twice today that I've been faked out. I'm not even in the race. That's quite common. I find it almost a little bit, I used to do it. But I find it almost comical. You always have that one person who wants to try to fake you out. And it's evident here, even in these qualifiers, which, I think, we kind of talked about it with our race winner from race 1 year old 10 about the tire situation for the 250. And even in the 250, I don't think you're going to see a massive need for new tires. It's definitely going to be important. But in this qualifier, that it doesn't look like thus far that there's going to be any need for any tire changes or fueling runs at this point. But then again, we did have two drivers run out of gas the first race. So if you're going to take the chance and run low, you might as well come in now, go ahead and top it off. 16 laps and you've gotten a little bit of benefit from it, and just call it good. But I think most of these drivers are going to be smart enough to just go ahead and fill it up from the start and play it safe.
Indeed, the tire wear certainly, well, wouldn't be an issue in this race or probably 250. For a couple of years ago, I did the full race without pitting at all, so on one set of tyres, which were pretty good by the end still. But a driver may wish to get a fresh set of tyres if they've had a spin or an incident like that, which would have given them flat spots, or if they've got a bit of damage that they might want to repair.
Well,
but
Steve,
no one has taken the option thus far.
Well, Steve, you pretty much already answered the question that I'm going to ask, but just to get a little bit more detail out of that, for the 250, what is your mindset in terms of tires? Because, from the old school days, it seemed like that, you would almost want to go put laps on tires and then cool them off under these cautions, and the longer you could keep those tires, the better they would be on the long run. Is that something that for the 250 you're going to plan for, i.e., are you going to change tires? Do you think that's something that a lot of teams are going to do, or do you think most of your teams are going to just run the same set for the whole race?
I imagine that most drivers will want to use the same set for the whole race. I mean, as you alluded to, as the tire life goes on, once you've got past the phase where they're getting warm, where you do sometimes have to manage them a bit to avoid them getting too warm, because then that's a vicious cycle that will just spin out of control. As long as you keep that in check, then later on the tires will cool down. They'll be much better to you, and it's even something which you'll get in a race of this distance, which I found in the first race. Once it got to a certain point, getting towards the end, the tires were cooling down naturally, and it's just fire eater to manage them.
Yeah, exactly. And obviously that depends on how many green flag laps we're going to have on those tires in the 250, because who knows how many cautions we may or may not have. But that's a good point. It's an interesting point, because like you said, once you have that first thermal degradation period over with, it's never comes back as hard. But back to the race, Oscar Hardwick going to take the restart from the pole, and got a single file restart coming, so let's see how well the field starts bunched up nicely. Very smart from Hardwick to start from the outside, like I was just informed of. Nobody passing before the line, and a green flag start. Gaps compile just a little bit, but I'm sure that's going to be short term. Back in the back, we got some three wide action. Bit of contact in the back.
And this is all around the final transfer spot as well. This go-karts, the spot is somewhere in the middle of the pack. That's all close together at the moment. I think it's Celius who is in that position at the moment.
Yeah, that's a good point. And Corn's falling back just a little bit after that contact on the back stretch. We've talked quite a bit about him. Status in the final transfer position, but they're definitely fighting hard to get up there right now. Corns and Harmon side by side going into turn one.
if you're in a battle at this stage of the race for this spot, you don't really want to be thinking about who's in that position at that time. You gotta play it smart and pick someone and work with someone to try and secure the position rather than battling it out when you've still got over two-thirds of this twin race still to go.
Yeah, exactly. That was a big talking point from race one, and it right now it's all about, you know, number one, like you said, building alliances. You know, how hard do you want to push? You know, let's conserve our equipment, let's conserve our tires, let's conserve our car, and let's try to pair up with somebody and make some distance. Right now, you can clearly see this final transfer spot falling away. Oh, Korn's losing it all by himself. Into the inside wall, big contact right there.
The track stays green because he's all on his own and there's no cars coming. That's really not good for Collins because he's going to be a long way back.
It's not at all. He doesn't appear to have any suspension damage, but a lot of left front damage. If any of that drags the ground, that could definitely hinder his performance. But back to what I was saying, there's a big gap there from 12th on back, and that's exactly the reason. Just fighting a little too hard, too soon. It is the final transfer spot, but long way to go. Yeah, meanwhile, back up at the front, Hardwick and Kapal stretching that lead out. It looks like they have solidified their alliance, and it looks like Hall's going to have to find someone to work with, or he's just going to have to try to mingle in that group the best he can and tag onto the end and wait till the end of the race and try to make a move. But right now he seems to be the lone wolf. Shepherd and Kingsbury behind with Blauhoff. Blauhoff could be that lone horse he needs. Hall, once again, you know, I don't want to sound like I'm bragging too much on this guy, but just a good all-around pace by himself up here, running fairly decent lap times. I mean, we're talking low 48s all by himself. That's the same lap time Jarl was running by himself when he lost Kenneth O'Keefe. So just all-around quick race car, but he's definitely going to get gobbled up by Shepherd and Kingsbury here.
Yeah, it's certainly a decent pace, but when you've got two cars working together, bump drafting efficiently, then the pace is going to be so much faster than anything that anyone can do on their own.
Absolutely, and this is where Hall really, you know, from a racing driver standpoint, without any engineering background to help him on this, he's got to think about what is his race strategy going to be right now. Does he want to fall in behind Kingsbury? Does he want to wait up on Blauhoff? He may not be aware of Blauhoff's position being alone as well. He probably in his strategy to stay with Kingsbury, but if he wants to try to branch off and create an alliance with Blauhoff, now's the time to do that.
And these two have been working together pretty well throughout the race, so it's unlikely that they'll want to get too far apart from one another and split off with Hall.
That's exactly true. I mean, Hall, despite the speed of his car, that's one thing that maybe he has lacked to do, or maybe he just hasn't had the opportunity to do, is build an alliance with someone else in this race. And as we know, that's extremely important in auto racing and simulation racing alike. I am getting reports that he is a rookie this year, so that answers all our questions. There we go. But now he's got plenty of time to solidify himself with somebody else in this race. I mean, like I said, Kingsbury just about lost it to get a pick lap, lag tap. Hall might have got his partner after all. It might not have been the guy he was looking for, but he found one.
I mean, he's going to be right in the back of Shepherd very quickly indeed. Matt Kingsbury is nowhere now, down in fifth. But he's going to be a long way behind these two, not close enough to tag along, assuming they can bump their way forwards.
Exactly, and from a strategist standpoint, it really works out well. Hall going for a pass here, a little bit surprising.
And he almost got squeezed against the wall going through the kink.
Yeah, Shepherd probably wasn't expecting that. He's probably expecting a big tap. But
exactly, yeah, I certainly would have been expecting to be overtaken in that sort of situation.
Absolutely not, because this gives the opportunity that if Shepherd wants to fall behind and regroup with his quote-unquote partner, that he has the opportunity to do that. Hall should have pushed and kept that spread, but we'll see what plays out here. That may be okay if Shepherd decides to split from Kingsbury. From a strategist standpoint, it's actually quite simple. Kingsbury has Blauhoff to fall back on. Hall now has Shepard, which once again, here they are, two abreast, contacting the outside pole from Hall. Drivers being drivers right here, not being strategists, that's for sure, because this makes no sense.
Indeed, Hardwick and Kapow up front must be reveling at the prospect of the guys that they're trying to drive away from fighting with each other rather than working with each other. It's just not going to work.
It surprises me even more because we saw Hall early in the race fall behind Hardwick and Kapow and seem to be quite content. And I don't know if there's a discomposition between him and Shepard that they don't want to work together or what the situation is, but it doesn't appear like they want to bump together for some reason. But once again, look back a little bit further, Blauhoff and Major are now connected, and then you've got the two Kingsbury brothers. So they smartened up, they fell back, they got together, they're going to run it out as a team. Let's see if Hall and Shepard can do the same.
An interesting thing to note with these two working together is Hall, of course, it doesn't matter what he does in this race, he will start from the outside of the front row on Saturday, no matter what, whereas Shepard, he's fighting for a grid position still. It's two different mentalities in terms of the approach to what they want from this race.
Absolutely, that's a good point. You know, Hall, from that perspective, should be trying to make as many friends as he can. Right now, now is the time. Just make as many friends as you can. Push him a little bit. Just drop off. Go push somebody else. Make him like you. Make him lucky for the 250. Oh, Shepard in the outside wall a little bit. Looked like another little bit of a lag right there. Pushed him to the outside wall. Wasn't as big as we've seen. Falling back in line here. Looks like they're going to be able to reestablish what little connection they have and maybe try to pull away from Blauhoff and Major, who actually have won two practice races together, from what I've been told. They work together quite a bit. I know each other really well, so it looks like a twosome that can really come up to the front and maybe take third and fourth away from these two guys if they don't start working together a little bit better.
It's a bit been an incident involved with another 29 car, Stadius, and it was on the grass on the inside of turn 2, and he went straight to joining the spectators rather than continuing with the race, which is an odd one. I'm not sure exactly what happened there, but he's taken no further part in this race.
Yeah, absolutely, that's a little bit odd. Just to give a quick update on our transfer positions and what's going on a little bit further back in the back, in 11th we have Fernandez, we have Goga in 12th, that is our final transfer, and together, those two cars were single, together in 14th and 15th we have Falkenberg and Harmon, so that could get interesting as the run goes on, because Goga is all by himself, with no help, not even close to him, and we've got two cars drafting together behind him for the final transfer, so we'll keep you updated on that as we go. Just after I bragged on Major and Blauhoff for working together so well in the practice races, looks like they had a little bit of a moment spread out and allowed the two Kingsbury brothers to catch up. This could get real interesting real fast. Blauhoff a little bit sideways on the straight. I don't know how much the Kingsbury brothers want to wait, but they look like they're quite aggressive. It looks like they may go for a move here. Thank you.
Hardwick and Capel making it look easy, leading this lap, as they have done for pretty much the entire race, and that is the halfway point. A little bit further back, Shepard and Hall. Shepard and Hall really having a hard time working together still. Hall into the outside wall through the trial there. Lost a big gap. You know, the rookie mentality, or I should say that he's new to the series. I don't want to say that he's a rookie, but showing a lot of talent on his straight line speed. But working together seems to be the downfall for him. He's going to want to work on that for the 250. And right behind then we have Major Blauhoff and the two Kingsbury brothers for 5th through 8th. I really and truly believe that if Shepard and Hall don't pair up here soon, they're going to have a lot of competition on their hand, not just two cars, but four cars, if they can stay lined up like this. I said the Kingsbury brothers wanted to get aggressive, but looks like they played it smart. They fell in line. Four cars work better than two on a long run if you can make it work. And they may be able to catch the two up here, Hall and Shepard. Oh, and as soon as I say that, Blauhoff off into the grass, hits the two Kingsbury brothers, they lose the draft.
And it's Matt who's lost out a lot more from that one.
Yeah, absolutely. Looks like he's lost the draft completely. And Whittawars, right behind him, actually may have the opportunity to get in that draft. Now keep in mind, that's a quick race car. I believe he started second on the grid in this race, so he's fallen back a little bit. We haven't talked about him much, mainly because we can't pronounce his name. But, yeah, he's got a quick race car. He's been coming up the field really quickly. I mean, he's been all by himself and somehow maintaining that gap to the four-car draft in front of him. About in race two than there was race one. I mean, got a big group, Hardwick and Capel up in the front, though, just making it look easy, just lap after lap, just sheer, not absolute unbelievable pace, but just nice, comfortable bump drafting, just making it look easy. It's going to be a good group to look for in the 250 if they can get paired up together. They're really showing their strength now.
I don't pronounce, however it's pronounced, is side by side with Matt Kingsbury for 8th place at the moment. He's gotten past, but he hasn't held on. They should better work together, but they're still side by side. Either they're truly battling or they can't decide who wants to be in front as they go to turn 3. And they're going to remain side by side coming off turn 3. But Matt's going to spot him behind. And we'll see if he's going to bump. There's some beeping off the horn, so someone's not happy about this. Meanwhile, for 5th place, we've got Major, Ray Kingsbury, and Blauhoff. The latter two have caught up to Major, who was on his own. Now, it'll be interesting to see how these three deal with there being 3 of them, whether 2 of them can make a break for it.
Yeah, I honestly believe that's definitely a possibility, but... you know, I've been really paying attention to this Hull and Shepard battle, and every time I go to their cars on track, they're in a different position, which can't be good. So they're probably be a good thing for them to just try to stay three abreast here, or not three abreast, but stay three line here, and go ahead and try to catch those two, because it looks like it's going to be fairly doable if they can't start working better together. You know, I've said it all race, but you know, the lap times just aren't there. Every now and then they'll run a nice mid 47, you know, upper 47, but there's just no consistency. Since we've updated you on that that final transfer position, Goga, as I mentioned earlier, in the final spot, Harmon and Falkenberg were together, and they still are together, but for some reason, Goga is much, much quicker than them. They are all over the track. Doesn't look like they're able to work with each other. Falkenberg has a little bit of right front damage, so we must have missed that, but you know, it's purely cosmetic at this point. But yeah, big gap for Goga now, so looks like, unless we get a caution, he might have that transfer position locked up.
Indeed, he had that spin earlier, which caused our first and so far only caution of the race. He was coming out of turn three, but he's managed to get himself back up into that top 12, that final transfer spot.
And he's done it with almost purely no help that I've seen throughout this entire run. I mean, he fell back fairly early from the restart, and stayed right there. But as I alluded to earlier in the first race, you know, we have, it's much tighter throughout the entire field. But you know, you go back to 10th, 11th, 12th position from, you know, Kagas to Fernandez to Goga. I mean, they're just spread out, and they're very close. So it might be an opportunity for Fernandez and Goga to maybe, you know, pair up and try to get Kagas and make sure that they can solidify themselves into the race, because, you know, granted it's not necessary, but go ahead and get as much, you know, space as you can in case, God forbid, something happens and you're to lose that position. Meanwhile, back up at the front, back in 5th and 6th position, we have Majur and Kingsbury, and it looks like they might have been able to break away from Blauhoff. Blauhoff lagging behind just a little bit now. For once in the race, I've switched back and forth from Hull and Shepard, and they're actually in the same position they were when I left them, so it looks like they're working together a little bit better. Their pace has improved quite a bit. Actually, I think they're probably just a little bit quicker than Hardwick and Capel, but not by much. Nah, I take that back. It looks fairly much line of stern.
We just had a mistake from Ray Kingsbury, trying to bump Majur just before turn two, and it was got it slightly wrong, and he's dropped back, and now Blauhoff is side by side of him into turn one, and it gets ahead.
Just noticed has a Dodge emblem on the hood of his car, so that motor's liable to let go any second. But yeah, with those two paired up, definitely Majur is gonna get caught up here. Thank you. race control. This is an interesting point for anybody that's had the opportunity to race in such a league or such a series, especially this oval-based series. Pretty much all of our drivers that are paired up, Hardwick, Kapal, Hall, Shepard, you know, all these guys, Blauhoff, they're in channels by them. They're not with the drivers that they're working with right now. They have no communication with those drivers, so they're purely making or racing on instinct at this point. There's no strategy going on between them, at least not that we're aware of.
Shepard has fallen back from Hull.
Exactly. This goes to show a little bit of the I hate to use the term inexperience because I'm unfamiliar with Hall, but you know, now is a good time to just back off, pair back up with Shepard. Don't gap this out. We know you've got a fast car, and he does have a fast enough car that I think that if he were to stay out there, he's gonna lose Shepard. And with Major and Blauhoff and Kingsbury back there, if they get a good run going here and working together, he could be in jeopardy of losing that position. Now, granted, he is locked in, but why not go ahead and pair back up and make sure that you get Shepard that position, and maybe if a caution comes out, you can win the race.
Indeed, it's definitely worth the loss of a bit of time to drop back and regroup with someone, rather than being on your own for too long. The benefits of being with someone far outweigh the losses of dropping back briefly.
Yeah, precisely. And we've talked about Hall, and from what I've seen this race, a little bit of an inability to have a partner. And him and Shepard were, you know, slowly gaining that alliance. So if a caution were to come out, I think it would be a good idea to help Shepard out right here. You know, get him on your side, work with him a little bit, and then if that caution comes out and you're fighting for the win, you know, he might be there for you. Whereas if Blauhoff were to get past Shepard, there was a caution.
We got Woodrow's is timing out, it seems. And he's might be reappearing. It's lagging out on my screen now again.
Yeah, same as here. That does not appear. That appears to be terminal. Does not look good.
Well, it seems he's back from the brink on my screen, at least.
Yeah, unbelievable timeout to come back for what it was.
It's going again though.
This is more exciting than the race itself. I mean, look at this. This is unbelievable. Look at the time to time out. And he's back for me. I feel like I'm watching Masters of Endurance. You know, back to what we were talking about a little bit earlier. Hall has stretched that gap with Shepard. Personally under the influence that Shepard has probably lifted a little bit, judging by how quickly he's fallen back to that group. We'll look at the times as the laps go on, but, you know, 48.13 for Hall last lap, with Blauhoff running a 47.74. So, you know, it would have definitely been in Hall's best interest to fall back, grab Shepard, and keep that gap. Now, whoa, yeah, a little bit of contact there. Now, we've got a little bit of time left in the race. We'll see if they can catch him. If they can't catch him, it's going to end up to really bite him, I think. Plus, you have that ability to build alliance with Shepard. So, why give that up? I don't understand. Oh, and of all people to time out, Stadia. What is that, Stadius? Oh, and as a correction, that was our driver that went through the grass and spectated earlier, so don't mind. This time by Hall in third position, running a really strong 48.11, excuse me. But meanwhile, back a little bit further, 47.91 for Blauhoff. So it looks like they're going to have time to catch this this driver in third position, Mr. Hall. Shepard may or may not have lifted to catch this group. I think it was probably in his best interest to not do so, but either way, if they catch Mr. Hall, it's not going to matter, but he is definitely fighting for a position where Hall, keep in mind, is in that position already. He qualified second. He is not racing for a qualifying position.
Yeah, Shepard's just hacking along at the back of this group at the moment. It's not really help to propel him forward, but he's not really losing that much ground to them either.
Yeah, I spoke a little too soon earlier saying that Shepard should have probably dropped from Hall if Hall was not going to lift for him, but you know, really in reality, I don't think he would have been able to outrun them either way. But being that he's not locked in, it might have been in his best interest to stay out in front and try to stay ahead of the group. But they may work faster, you know, with four cars, and may be able to catch Hall if not otherwise. But you know, either way, it's probably not going to hurt or help Shepard too much. But in the long run, it may be a little bit of a hindrance. Come. Yeah, 250 day. Ten laps to go, and we've pretty much forgotten about him. Hardwick and Kapal just up front, just dominating this race. Hardwick and Kapal have worked together really well this race. It's kind of makes it interesting to think what Kapal may be thinking to win this race. You know, does he want to go out there? Does he want to try to win it? Does he want to try to get that position for the 250? Does he want to get Hardwick on his good side? That's something he's got to think about, something that he needs to make a decision on really quickly, because we are nearing the end of this race. Eight laps to go this time by. I do not know the alliance of Kapal and Hardwick, so it's hard to specify, but as a drafting group, they are doing an exquisite job of just putting out consistent lap after lap, you know, mid to high 47s, just absolutely just on the edge, perfect. This is exactly what you want for the 250, and this is good practice for them, and it's a good alliance building, regardless what happens at the end of the race. God forbid they take each other out, hate each other, but as long as that doesn't happen, this could be a good group to win the 250 division from their overall pace and consistency.
Indeed, it's been a masterclass really of how to have a lead pair in a race on this combination. They've been very quiet and very quick, and that's exactly what you want when you're up front.
It's something I've been paying attention to pretty much the last 5-6 laps is Hall's gap to Blauhoff and Majeur. And that is closing drastically, and Hall is pretty much almost... Oh! I say that just as Majeur gets a little bit of a lag tap, goes on the outside wall, but pretty much has to be caught by Blauhoff and Majeur. Hall has to be. There's just no way he can get away from it, and Kingsbury and Shepard are right there to capitalize on his speed differential. So this could end in tears for Hall in terms of finishing position. And this purely for bragging rights. So I think in Hall's position, I said one of two things right now. One of two things is for sure: make that alliance, become friends with somebody, or finish, you know, third position in this race and make yourself look good, because he's done it pretty much all by himself. And just as I say that, Blauhoff and Kingsbury, oh my god, they touch. Blauhoff's going to easily control that car way up to the outside wall. Major keeping that alliance with Blauhoff. He's going to come up top and help him out.
No, he's not. He's going to drop down to join Ray Kingsbury and Shane Shepherd and try and tag along with those guys.
Yeah, good job. Good position play for Major, though, to take that position, because he's not going to get past Shepherd or Kingsbury, but he's going to keep that momentum going and help Blauhoff in the end with a good run to the front stretch here. And, you know, here we go with about five laps to go, and Hall's got to be gobbled up here. The question is can these four drivers get there without wrecking each other?
And this is inevitably going to become five cars when they reach Hall, so that's going to just complicate matters further, how they're going to coordinate each other.
Yeah, definitely having an odd number in an oval race is never a good thing, and that's exactly what that's going to create. The pace is fairly consistent. You know, we're looking at really good split times from that four car group. 16.6s, 16.5s for Major Blauhoff there. Hall all the way up in the 16.7s, mid 16.7s, might I add. This time by Hall with a 47.96. That's one of the fastest single car laps I've seen all day. However, Kingsbury 47.84 lost a little bit in that final sector. Goodness me, Kingsbury and Shepard. Major contact. Shepard trying to force his way in here. Not necessary. Blauhoff having nothing of it. Not giving him any room there. He's forced right up against the wall. However, he's not going to give him any position to get in. Shepard may make it, though. He did. Unbelievable. Fantastic move from Shepard. A little aggressive. We're under the influence now that Major and Ray Kingsbury actually have communication with each other, even though they haven't had the opportunity to work with each other. At this point, it doesn't look like any of these four drivers are working with each other. Shepard down at the bottom now. Kingsbury all the way up at the top, was just leading that pack. Is back at the back now. They need to play it smart to catch Hall, but it looks like they're just going to pretty much battle it out for this fourth position.
And this could all end in tears. We've got two laps to go, and push is going to come to shove, really. They've got a grid position on the 250 to fight for, and it looks like they're probably starting to consider that at this stage of the race.
Yeah, one would definitely hope that they're considering it, but judging from that last lap, they're really fighting for it. A little bit surprising, actually. A little bit nerve-wracking. Oh, a little more contact. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just commenting the same thing that you were. Blauhoff goes into the wall after turn one, and he's just about with Ray Kingsbury still, who backs off a bit to help him out, but they've been dropped by Major and Shepherd.
Yeah, Oscar Hardwick takes the white flag. One lap to go. We'll see if Kapow can make a shot to win this race. Meanwhile, a little bit of inexperience further back, Shepherd Major, they're going to lose Hall. It doesn't look like they're going to be able to catch him. I thought that they were going to try to get that position for bragging rights, but it looks like it's all grid position for the 250 for these four. Hardwick and Kapow going to the final corner. Looks like they're going to finish in line here, unless Kapow wants to make a move. It's definitely possible. He's got that bottom line working well. Hardwick a little bit higher up on the track. Nah, it looks like they're going to stay in line. Oh, wait, Kapow fakes him out.
He's going for it,
but
he's not quite got it right. Hardwick is going
to
stay ahead and win the second twin 115.
Yeah, absolutely. And Hall, Shepherd, Major going to run in line at the end. Kingsbury, Blauhoff. Meanwhile, back in the back, Goga is going to take our transfer spot behind Kagas. Actually made up quite a bit of track space to him, quite a bit of a gap he made up there at the final section of that race, but a little bit further back, quite a ways back, is Harmon going to end up in 13th position. Behind him we have Korns and Falkenberg. That rounds out your top 15. We're going to try to get a quick interview with Oscar Hardwick here momentarily as soon as he finishes doing his post-race celebrations. Oscar Hardwick, congratulations.
Hello. Thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome very much. How was that race on a whole? Go ahead and describe those last couple laps. Do you think I was going to be able to make a move on you?
Well, I knew that Martin's a very, very clean driver, so I knew that he wouldn't, you know, put me in a wall or anything, but I did also have in the back of my mind, I knew that he was going to make a move. So the whole of the last lap, I could hear him backing off the throttle a lot more than he had been previously, so I was just literally coasting through the corners, letting him push me. And let him just give me a sort of accidental bump entering turn three, which gave me just about enough of a run to keep it to the line, and obviously I squeezed him a bit towards the wall, and he went for the outside, which gave him plenty of time to run down to the bottom, get to the line first. But all in all, great racing, and it was lovely that even after that caution, we could make a restart where me and Martin could actually pull away from everyone else, and it just worked perfectly. Brilliant, brilliant race.
Yeah, absolutely. We were commenting, you know, throughout the entire race, how you pretty much dominated with Kapal, and your race pace on average was pretty much the best we've seen all day. Is that an alliance you're going to take to the 250? Is that something you guys are going to work on together and try to stretch when it comes money time? Is that your partner?
Well, it may well be. I mean, you never know who you're going to end up near in the race, but through practice sessions and now this as well, I know that, you know, Kapal is great to draft with. We weren't necessarily the fastest over a single lap when we were bumping, but like you say, the average was absolutely perfect. You know, 47.8s really, just that was our average. Every single lap we could do that. It did work perfectly. I can see Martin on the server now. He's saying that he should have made a move at a different point. But, you know, I'd sort of figured out where he could have made a move come to the end of the race and had it covered as well as I could have done. And it did work out for me just about.
Well, as we said, you know, it might be best just to take that position and go on to the 250 and build that strong alliance, because you guys, on a whole, consistency-wise, were probably two of the best we've seen all day. So congratulations on that. Congratulations on the win.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations in the 250, because you've got a great grid position to start.
Yeah, same as last year, so a bit of repetition.
Well, where did you finish last year?
No, not last year, 2011, the last time I ran it, rather. Started fourth, finished fifth.
Well, hopefully you'll finish a little bit better than that.
Yeah, I'd love to finish a bit better.
There you go. Well, all right, my friend. I appreciate the interview, and good job, good race, and we'll see you in the 250.
Thank you very much.
If you would please just bear with us just a little bit longer. We're going to try to get a couple more drivers in here for interviews. All right, Martin Kapal, how are you doing, man? That was a good run. It's a good shot trying to win the race there. Walk us through those last couple laps.
Oh, hello. That wasn't a good shot at all, I think. I really did not expect him to just not block the inside as much. I could have just go inside, I think. Well, yeah, I tried. It was a good one, though. Yep.
I wasn't going to call you out on it, but yeah. No, I'm just kidding, man. That was a good run. You guys just totally dominated earlier. I don't know if you heard the interview before, but you guys totally dominated all day long. Purely consistent, just wonderful laps. You know, like I ask Hardwick, and I want to get your opinion on the same question. Is Hardwick your man for the 250? Is that where your alliance lies, or is there anybody in particular else that you may end up working with?
Well, that's true that the bun drafting was really good with him. But well, there are some of my teammates. Well, my teammate, another colleague. I think I'm just going to try to work with him. But if I don't get to him on track, I'll just work with some people like Oscar, for example. Yeah, and I'll just see. Just try to stay at the front pack and try to work there. Yeah, good race overall.
It was, and in all seriousness, just giving you a hard time about that move at the end. It looked like it was going to work, in all honesty. It looked like a good move, but at the same time, you know, you built that alliance with Hardwick, so, you know, once again, just fantastic job. Thank you for the interview. If you have anything to add about the 250, I mean, what is your strategy before I let you go on the 250? Is there anything in particular, tire strategy, that you're looking forward to, maybe doing a little bit different than anybody else, or are you going to go out there and try to work with your team and just try to run on one center?
Well, what I tried last year was to finish without the pit stop, so that's what I'm going to try this time. So just with one set of tires and with 100% of fuel, and try to work with some guys, try to not lose the bump draft. I think that's all.
Hey, well, I wish you the best of luck in the 250. Good job today.
Thanks.
All right, last but certainly not least for interview, we have Robin Frickops. Am I pronouncing that right? Enlighten me.
Frickops.
Excuse me. Are you there, Robin?
Yeah, hi.
Hey, how are you doing? It's been a while since we've watched your race, but all in all, how was the car today?
Well, I was trying something different in like the twin race. I tried to drive it a qual setup I hadn't tried in a race before, and it didn't go very well. But well, I had some right front camber damage the whole race, so I was overheating at all time. I had no pace, so it could have been better. But in qualifying, it went perfectly, so I'm happy with that, getting pole position.
Yeah, congratulations. The NX car looked good out in front today. We were actually commenting on that in the race about the camber and how your tires look. So for the 250, do you think you're going to dumb that down a little bit, maybe run a little bit more conservative race car?
Well, I think I'm just going to go back to the old setup that has been proven to work, so which I've been using like all the years before, and so has Phil used before as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It, you know, once again, that's something we definitely noticed in the first race. It did look quite aggressive. It's probably worth the risk, you know, in all honesty, because you were locked in. So, you know, it's a good finish regardless in that first race. Lastly, who do you think you're going to be working with in the 250? Anybody we may know?
Well, it's basically like this year, there's a lot of people that are capable of bump drafting from what I've noticed. They have high pace. It's basically just going to be whoever I come together with, and then of course gonna work extra much with my teammate Phil, but it's basically just gonna be trying to get to the front with anyone, and then we see how it goes.
Yeah, absolutely. We figured we were banking on you and Phil working together, but we were gonna see what you said first, because Phil was a little anxious. He didn't know if you were gonna work with him or not. No, I'm just kidding you. But yeah, we look forward to the 250. We'll see you on Saturday. Good job in the first race. It was a good pace. And considering running the extra camber, which we were notating in all seriousness throughout the broadcast, I think it was a good finishing position, because I noticed that right front was really in the red for quite a bit of that first run. So good job. Good job on, I think it was third place overall, correct?
Yeah, correct.
Yep, third place overall in the first qualifier. So we'll see you on Saturday. Thank you for the interview.
Thank you.
All right, everyone. I think that's going to pretty much wrap it up for the 2013 Kyoto 250 qualifiers. I'm Nolan Scott. Alongside me, Stephen Martin. Stephen, you have anything to add on the day? What are you looking forward to for the 250?
Well, I think today's race is really whet the appetite for the main event. We've had some good racing. We've had a lot of clean racing. We've only had two cautions throughout the day. Hopefully we get some long runs where we see all the strategy and all the intricacies of the event play out and we get a fun race.
Well, we wish you the best of luck, Steve, in the race. And last but not least, join us again Saturday, 1745 UTC for the green flag. Broadcast will start at 1730. So join us. We look forward to it and have a wonderful evening.